Hello world. I think I can start now.
Yeah, if you just want to start, Benjamin. So it's 18 o'clock. Let's go.
Yeah. Thanks. My name is Benjamin Henrion. I'm Belgian. I work with Pieter. I knew Pieter since 2005. I met Pieter somewhere around the European Parliament. We were fighting the software patent directive, and Pieter was running a company, IMITX, a Belgian company based in Brussels. And the company was doing a gateway to do SMS to email. And they received a threat letter from a patent troll who was claiming a patent on matching a telephone number to an email address in a database. Basically, the concept of an email to an SMS to email gateway. So IMATIC was developing a product for Belgacom Proximus at the time. And the patent troll sends threat letters to any, basically any telco in Belgium or any company that was doing a gateway for SMS to email. And so Pieter had a project with Proximus Belgacom for events, for like you send a short SMS. And so Proximus was threatened, and they said from basically after a week that they're going to drop the project where Pieter invested quite a lot of resources in people. And at that time, it ended up as the termination of the project, and he fired five people at IMATIX. And that's where he came to the software patent debate, because at the time, the European Parliament was debating it quite heavily. And when I went there, where he was speaking around the European Parliament, he was like in a hotel with MEPs. And the EPO and other enemies were trying to destroy any presentation from our side. Destroying the projector, destroying the presentation, making noise, whatever. And Pieter was so upset, he said, okay, this is my turn. I'm gonna make it and destroy this whole thing. He was so upset, and for me, he made the best speech I've ever seen on the topic. He was a victim of patent trolling, which was not called patent trolling at the time, because patent trolling came in 2006 with RIM and NTP in the US at least. And so I met him afterwards, and we successfully managed to stop the directive in a way where the large companies basically asked to drop the directive, and that's what the European Parliament did. And they did that to better push for what is called the community patent, or now the unitary patent, which is being currently ratified in all the EU countries. So the fight we had was very intense. I was spending most of my time on this, and I had to delay my university final examination, and at some point he said, being the president, the new president of the FFII, the association, he said, I need your help in Brussels, we're going to work together. And that was 2006, and basically 6 months after the rejection of the directive in July, the commission announced that they're going to relaunch the community patent and the attempt to create a patent system for Europe. So it gave us a lot of work. We worked on EUPACO, which is the European Patent Conference. And then at some point, I set up a website called noxml.org, where I set up a petition against the standardization of OpenXML, which is DocX and XLXX and so on, that Microsoft tried to standardized ISO, because they saw that ODF was already an ISO standard, and all the governments were trying to impose ODF as a reference standard, so Microsoft could not be in any public public call for public markets, which are big markets. And then, so we had this big fight about OOXMLOffice, which is now 10 years, it's going to be the 10 years anniversary this year. So I set up this petition, and it was a Friday, and we were testing the new Wikidot platform, which is a wiki farm where he invested in the company in Poland. We were testing the new module for the petition, and so we put up this petition online. I put it up, and I booked the domain name NoXML with 3.0. And Peter said, it's never going to work. There are 3.0s, nobody is going to type. And then I launched the petition like on Friday night, and when we came back on Monday morning, we had like 10,000 signatures from Linux Russia or something. So that's how we started to work on this. We didn't have really any plans, but we got hooked up, and at some point, I think a lot of people had good memories of crazy stories with Microsoft gold partners stuffing the committees, corrupting the process, and at the end we put a price for the best team who was fighting the OpenXML standardization, and we put out a prize money of 3,000 euros. And at the end, we were looking at who was the best team against OpenXML, and Peter came with the idea that Microsoft itself was the best team to fight against its own standard. So he crafted out the prize, the Kayak Award, and gave it to Microsoft. And later on, Peter was invited to talk on a podium with a Microsoft speaker, and the Microsoft spokesman was a bit irritated because he asked Peter, is that you who gave us this fucking award? So, and after that, he made a nice song.
Hi, this is a song for all those brave men and women who spend their lives looking for the truth and never quite finding it. Yes, this is called Microsoft. We love you.
So yeah, we had this friend who made this Wonderful. So, yeah, good times. I tried to stop it in a way. And this is one of the flyers that Peter wrote in a sarcastic way. I was giving out before in the platform, the train station, to politicians. And this one created some controversy inside our group because he was sarcastic. That was another. So we had Wikidot, and we were like trying the engine to make campaigns, and Peter had the idea to design the best keyboard. So he was upset with his caps lock, to go in uppercase, which actually comes from a long time ago when you had terminalmetastasis. And he wanted to get rid of it, so he made a contest for the best keyboard design. And I think there was some winner for some layout, or that was really fun. So in the history, I don't know if there are still users of Xitami in the room, or someone used. So I had a friend who was using this web server in the 90s under Windows, and actually that was the number one web server in around 1997 or 8. It got many awards, and that was like the best. Before Apache, was one of the best web server, and I think it was known. There were a lot of users, especially in Windows, for that. Yeah, I'm gonna quit the slides. Actually, Peter didn't like much when you have slides, so I'm gonna put. And one thing, so I worked with Peter for 3 years, from 2006 to 2009. Then at the end, I made work on OpenMQ with AMQP standardization work group, where there was Red Hat, IBM, all the others. Peter developed very interesting concepts around code generation. Most of the Xitami web server was based on code generation with tools like GSL, Libero, where basically you define a model in XML, and which defines your application, and then GSL is going to generate C code. And I think he was one of the few persons in the world to adopt this methodology with a focus on multi-threading, let's say, have the best usage of all your resources. So this period I worked on OpenMQ, which was the broker. Basically, in the messaging world, you have the client, the server, and basically you put a broker as a server, and you talk to it. So we had a client, JP Morgan Chase, in New York, where we were trying to optimize the speed and get the highest number of messages per second we could get with the broker, OpenMQ broker. And so basically, after a while, it took me a while to realize that we were working on high-frequency trading. And so we had this model. We had this standardization work as well. And at some point, Peter was very upset about Red Hat. Red Hat filed a number of patents around the AMQP. Red Hat also, one of the chairman of the committee, tried to basically buy his credit for put his name as the main author of the specification, which made Peter very upset and very, let's say, very upset about this whole standardization process. So at some point, I spent a lot of money on trying to participate in the standard process, and it just went out of the process and looked for better solutions. And so this search for speed came to the simple model, which is point to point. So when you have 2 points, without the broker in the middle, or the third the broker and the third point, you remove the broker and you have messages between A to B, and you try to maximize the speed you can get between those 2 points and try to remove the broker in the middle. And that gave birth to ZeroMQ. ZeroMQ was bought by iMatics from a Slovakian company, Martin, somewhere in Slovakia. And they basically focused on that aspect for a while, and they managed to get the highest performance. I've seen graphs, but basically they were destroying all the other competitors on the market with a million messages. And so the frustration with OpenMQ gave birth to ZeroMQ, which at the beginning was really like a library, network library for developers, which it still is. But with the time, there were many more people coming. ZeroMQ is done in C++, and so it's a core library, and there are bindings for I don't know how many languages on top, but basically whether it's Rust, Python, or Java, or OCaml, or I think we used the one which language I don't remember. We use funny languages on top. So you have this big community trying to make things connected together, talking together. Typically, you need to load balance things across multiple servers. You would use ZeroMQ for that. So, and then 2009, 2010, Peter had a project with Samsung in South Korea, not North Korea, where the goal was to make two smartphones talk to each other. And they worked on some kind of a mesh with the Wi-Fi, at some point I think he went to some sushi restaurants. And he came back from South Korea with some yellow skin. Or I visited him at the hospital at the time, and he had yellow skin. And apparently when you eat sushi and fish that is not very fresh fish but with some kind of parasite in there, the parasite develops something in the duodenum, and this creates some kind of cancer cells. So the yellow color was coming from this area, which was damaged by growing cancer. So he got an operation out of that. They removed part of the duodenum. And from that moment in time, I think his life changed. He started to take more time with his family, write some books about programming, about ZeroMQ, he was a different man. He took the decision to totally drop any effort in writing proprietary code anymore, and he focused on building the ZeroMQ community and writing only free software, and promised to never write proprietary software or closed software again. And looking at it from the outside, you can understand that someone wants at some point when his life might be shortened in the near future to leave a trace. So the trace now is mostly the ZeroMQ community, where we had a hackathon this weekend. Last year, in the same period, we had a hackathon in his garage. And I think a month after, He had his last conference in Munich, and he came back very sick. And I told him to visit the doctor, and the results coming from the doctor, coming from the test, were that he had metastasis in both lungs. He was coughing a lot, so I thought we were working in the garage. That was our new office that we keep it warm. And I thought it was something else, but it was his cancer that was back. And the diagnosis was really pretty much saying there's no chance to get out of it. That was in April, and we organized a big party in his garage in June. And so from there, we try to visit him as most as I can. And he made a very important, blog post about the protocol for dying, which is here somewhere. I'm not sure. And this blog post went viral on the internet to the point where the TV in Belgium, the newspaper in Belgium, both in the north or the south, were interested in his story, which is basically saying when someone is dying, don't try to cry on the phone. Try to remember the good times. And this went translated into many languages. Many people got touched by it. So it's a reference. And basically, they tried to say what was the diagnosis, what were the recommendations to talk to a dying person, what you should say, what you should not say. And I think he got a death which is different from the normal way, which in a sense he could clean things up before leaving. And he used his Twitter account quite as a mean for communicating with other people. And I think his father died in April, and his father chose to use euthanasia, which is legal in Belgium. And he said he's going to use the same method for deciding when he's going to leave. So I let you read. I'll give you 1 minute to let you read the top. I recommend you, he talks about those YouTube videos and recording some conferences where he went.
Sorry.
I prepared part of the video that it's an interview made by someone from Bilstadt in Vancouver, where he interviewed him like in July, and I think you could recognize. It's a long interview, it's like 1 hour, but the introduction is gonna...
Oh, good.
We have about 1 hour, then I should not go by my kids to bed, but
okay.
About an hour's time, so...
Okay, great. So maybe a good start would be just to explain why, we are where we are, and you wrote the protocol, and maybe a little bit of the history of how that unfortunate event happened, just so other people are aware of that these kinds of things exist. And
Are we recording that?
Yes, we are. Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, the model is don't eat cheap sushi.
Okay. It's expensive in Vancouver.
Yeah. There's this. There are a lot of poor people in the world still, and a lot of them have diseases which are dramatically bad, and which are ignored by the rest, because they're not, worth much money, they're not really in the focus of research. And, companies prefer to invest their time and effort in diseases for wealthy, not the poor. And one of those diseases in Southeast Asia is a little parasite, a little worm which lives in the duodenum, which is the life cycle, is basically it lives in fresh farmed fish. And if you eat the fish raw, and this is a delicacy, it's a kind of fermented raw fish or something like that, then the little worm attaches into your duodenum and it sits there for quite some time. And at a certain point in time, it begins to produce little carcinogens, which produce tumors, which the worm feeds off, because it likes it, because nature is weird like that. And so there's this, there's this high risk category, which is men at the age of 50 or so, who just basically they turn yellow and they die. And that's the symptom. Suddenly your skin goes yellow, your eyes go yellow, you start peeing yellow, and then a few weeks later, a month later, you're dead. And it's cost of doing business, basically, if you're a poor male in Southeast Asia and you eat fresh fish. So I suspect that there is a growing stream of cheap black market fresh fish coming into sushi and cheap sushi restaurants, which I used to love, cheap sushi restaurants. And so about 5 years ago, I began turning yellow, and I'm male in 50, roughly. And my eyes go slightly yellow, and I'm like, okay, this is not good news, let's check into the emergency. And they do the scan, and they find no blockage in my gallbladder, and my liver is fine. And so the only really other option is a tumor in the bile duct, which turns out to be a cancer, fairly aggressive and fairly far along the way, but not yet metastasized, so still sitting in one space. And so they cut me open and remove this thing. Must have been like, the scene from Alien, this thing with many tentacles just chopped out. And this is an amazing procedure called the Whipple, where they basically replumb your whole internal system. And that was pretty horrendous. But I got out of that and recovered from that. And we do, most of us are pretty robust when you get a chance to be. And the medicine is pretty, pretty good. I'm impressed, I have to say, by medicine, modern medicine. And especially in Belgium, where I don't have all the stress about, how are you going to pay for this stuff? The state covers that to some extent. You do pay for this. It's not going to bankrupt you ever. And that was all good. And I had this kind of very freaky few years where I was, I should have been dead, but I wasn't. And I knew I should have died because it was really very close both times. I mean, from the surgery was very, very dangerous, and the cancer was really aggressive. So I spent the next few years in a kind of a state of fluke, running around saying, wow, I should be dead, I'm not dead. And still it sinks in that I'm going to die at some point, but I might as well make the most of it. So I decided to become a writer and began writing my books. My blog dates from about that point in time. And we had some interesting projects, but I began to work more and more from home and spend time with my kids.
I think everyone noticed that you had pretty much a solid green contribution on your
head. Yeah. Yeah.
It's shocking to see it sort of stop, obviously, in the last couple of months, but it was amazing to see
just a non-contribution from one person.
Well, I actually did not. Then the problem with the GitHub thing is it's setting itself up for being game. So if there's a few days during the hour, I missed it. I'm like, no, I'm not going to miss it. So I go back to a project and make a patch and use the date option to backdate that. You know what I mean? It's just asking for trouble, right? When you give people this kind of thing.
Yeah.
I guess we all cheated at some point, so that was my little advice. Yeah. That's why I wrote a script to basically destroy the whole thing with the Pac-Man.
Right. That was very fun. What was the name of that project again?
Easter egg. Just an Easter egg. I don't know what I call it. Wacka Wacka, that's right.
Yeah, that's it. Yes, I never remember looking at it.
And it was kind of difficult to do because you've got to read the old contributions and build up new values, but you've got to build them up so they come to a constant, because otherwise you get these very bizarre effects, all the new added on top. Silly stuff. Yeah, so then beginning of this year, I guess around Easter, I got sick again, and I'm like, oh. And it was a bit of a chaotic moment in our family because my dad had just died, so we were obsessed by that. We're still figuring that one out. Death is a mess, generally. I noticed that. And there's a lot you can do to make death less of a mess. Doing things like preparing. Just, getting rid of your stuff before you die. I mean, it's very simple, but you get rid of stuff that you may appreciate before you die. And then when you're dead, no one has to argue about, who gets it, what you do with it. That kind of thing. So then I got a scan, and I got the biopsies, and I got another scan, and I got blood tests, and they were like, yeah, you have cancer in both lungs, and it's the same cancer coming back, mild cancer in your lung, which is pretty awful news because there's no chemotherapy for bowel cancer. Like, no one has really spent much time on this.
So it's an experimental treatment than what you're going through right now.
They didn't tell me quite how experimental it is or quite how much data they have. And they spent about a week. I had pneumonia from the biopsies. I got pretty sick from that. They're poking holes in their lungs. And, some bacteria move around. They shouldn't be there. So I got very sick from that. And then they were looking at me for a week and a half. What kind of chemo could we use? And they found some data somewhere suggesting that chemo, which is used for colon cancer, called FOLFOX, actually might work for bowel cancer with a bit of luck. So that's what they're giving me. And it turns out that it's actually working.
It is.
I don't know how well it's working, but it's doing something. I'm sure I'm still being dead by my own estimate.
Yeah, from your initial, the news was horrific to hear how aggressive it was. So, I've always told you to keep my fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Don't ever give up on anything. And that, you're putting faith in, if you want to use that word, into, what's out there, the science that's going on. So I'm very happy, ecstatic. I'm sure everyone else is to hear that.
Well, the science is very good, but the science doesn't care about individual cases.
No,
science is focused on data and collecting statistics, and there's a lot of gaps in there. All you have, even in this case, I don't even have statistics. I don't know what the chances really are. So I'm very happy to not be getting worse. I'm getting a little bit better, slowly better.
And if even in the worst possible sort of outcome, that it doesn't work anyway, at least like you said before, there's more data at least. That's one of the things you said in the article, right?
Right. And the medical machine works by massive parallel concurrent trial and error. It has these procedures that it applies very, very systematically, and they can be wrong in individual cases, but it applies them. And when it gets data that shows that they're wrong, it will improve them. And over time, it's, people keep sending me these emails suggesting, I should try this and try that, this diet and this alternative, and acupuncture, and I don't know, whatever else. Smoke some weed, do you good, dude? And I'm like, yeah, all that stuff is fun, but you can't compare a handful of individual cases against the medical machine. This is like, this is not a fair fight, And I do trust that.
You did give up sugar, correct? Or is this something you did already?
I gave that up a long time ago.
Well,
Yeah, I'm actually eating sugar again now because I really, really need the empty calories. Like, that's my body really needs that right now.
I wish some energy at this point for just to be able to get through the treatments.
The chemo is quite interesting. So it's basically one terrible week and one great week. And you just go through these cycles.
Is it every 2 weeks? Are you going back in?
Two weeks,
this week?
Yeah, Wednesday.
Okay, so you got a couple of good days left to enjoy it before it will take effect, and you're still okay on a Wednesday and a Thursday.
It's a sine curve. It doesn't hit immediately. It hits after a couple of days, and then it's just all I sleep all the time. I'm vomiting and I'm not eating. And if you touch my stuff, I'll rip your throat out. It gets into your mind when you don't sleep well. Yeah, you're tired. And then they get better and better, and everything begins to, you know, the things come back into color and 3D, and food begins to taste again. You taste better still.
One of the benefits of you needing to go through this in your life is the protocol for dying, which was a huge critical and had a worldwide impact, I would say, given that people have interviewed you about it on television and other places.
I was on television twice in that thing. Once in French, once in Dutch. It seems I'm in
the
world affected by it.
Guardian wrote an article, correct?
Yes, the Guardian, yes. Yeah. Lots of translations. Everyone is touched by this. Of course, death is a very general thing. We all experience it secondhand and then first time. In one way or another, and it's... I saw this with my dad when he died. It was very difficult to know what to do as a family. There's very little advice out there. I've had to... how to even organize, how to even, you know, deal with it. I'm sure there are lots of blogs and so on you could look for, but simple things like, you know, get a list of all your assets and bank accounts and stuff before you die. Don't wait until you're dead and people start hunting this stuff down. Don't make bizarre wills unless you want your family to fight. And he had euthanasia, which was a good thing. He needed it. He was very, very old. He really had no life except lying in bed, losing control over things. And as a family, we were able to use that to kind of plan things. And it was very healthy, I thought. It was very good for us. Not to have to just wait passively until he died, but actually be able to, you know, hold a party and come together and have the children there and, you know, do this. And then he died. And it was a very, very tidy and also, I think, very healthy way to have control. So that's also what I wanted to write about, the positives of that. People are very afraid of, I don't know, death panels and, you know, assisted suicide. And it's really not that. I mean, it's really about taking control.
Well, we're wired to fear death as a species. Keep ourselves going.
Yeah, exactly. It's just a little thing in the brain that doesn't want to die. But once you realize that it's really not about whether or not you die, it's how you live, which is really important. And we tend to forget that, don't we?
Yeah.
So yes, inspirational words.
It's always inspirational words, and from my point, I've obviously followed a lot of what you've done because of sort of how our paths. I came across all your work, and to have met you last year was a tremendously honored experience because. You know, of everything that I thought was more than reinforced about how amazing you're going, and you know, everything you write about how you live, about the social aspects where you were an introvert before, like that was myself, as glasses and belief, etc. I really identified with everything that you sort of said and how you turned out, because I also find tremendous stimulation about, you know, social things. So what you wrote about the community is incredible.
We had a great time building this. It was fantastic.
Yeah. It was very good.
And when you realize when you meet a lot of people, I spent the last 5 years doing a lot of conferences, and I've done that before, but not quite so focused. And what you realize is that most people are lovely. I mean, it's kind of confusing. We have these broad generalizations, you know, all these are that and all these are this. But turns out that most people are lovely, and most people are great to work with, and are always motivated to be, you know, good actors. And that's kind of the core philosophy of our community, is it's not to trust everybody, it's just to, like, that medicine, you know, we have the data, we know that this percentage of people are going to be good for the community. And that percentage is going to be bad for the community, and we want to filter them out rapidly, bring in the good, and then free them to do the right thing.
Yeah. I see a lot of that in all the open source, obviously, ZeroMQ, you know, open source, and a lot of other endeavors that have been open source, and Yeah, one of the things that would be nice to get from you is your outlook, just the philosophy. I mean, you've the patent system, the edge network, you've started, done a bunch of other things. I think the edge network kind of sidetracked because of the Tor initiative. Correct me if I'm wrong on this, but maybe we could dive into a little bit of, you know, the open source side and what drives you. You know, why does Pieter use his not one of those developers with a MacBook Pro sitting there hacking away at Ruby on Rails? He's a guy that's got some interesting tech behind him, and maybe go into that whole philosophy of why, as a consumer, you chose to make these choices to use certain equipment, use certain tech, or not use certain tech.
So I guess we all have a journey. Sometimes we can make big decisions, but I think they're always built out of small steps. And so first of all, open source as a choice. And I realized very clearly at a certain point, maybe I was about 40 years old, that all of my closed source projects were dead. Like literally, you would get money from a customer, you would build stuff with them, they would use it, and then it would die. And you're a supplier, and their goal was to replace you. And I had very, very few customers whose goal was to build a long-term relationship and pay maintenance. And I had one or two that paid maintenance for 15 years, but they were the exception. And the majority of customers were, okay, you're our plumber, you're our lawyer, you're a pure cost, and you come in, you build the stuff, and we will use it, and then you will go away, and as soon as we can, we will replace your stuff with something else, because that's what companies do, they like spending money. And the open source stuff that I made before, when I was still ideologically motivated, survived. And I've been making tools open source because, well, it wasn't really ideology. I wanted to use them in my work and I couldn't sell them. So I said, okay, I might as well make them open source. Before that, it was freeware and shareware. Yeah. And then I realized, okay, GPL, and I would use these tools like Libre and maybe GSL, because they were really, really necessary for the work I wanted to do. They made me a good consultant, they made me a much better developer. So the tools themselves were free to share, and then GPL, and then other licenses. And then I came back and had a lot of, you know, you build a company, you make money, you have to earn money, you have to pay for stuff. So I went back into commercial software development. And I realized afterwards it was just years of my life that were lost. And I guess my ego doesn't like that. My ego likes to think that the stuff I make will survive. I thought I had good ideas, which is kind of true up to a point. I shouldn't catch myself. Some of them are good. Some of them are really bad. But the notion that your stuff just is trash and it's just temporary is kind of offensive. I thought we could do better. And so I began really deliberately saying, okay, open source is the only way to grow. And then if I would waver on this, I would get the sharp reminder at a company in Poland, Wikidog, which still survives. But the company never really became a success. And the core reason was that the platform was closed source. And so you have this small company and all of its money goes into software development and customer support. And that's lethal. If you're building your own software by yourself, you can't compete. And the irony is that, of course, the whole stack is based on open source, but it's not open source.
Great.
So, I hope you enjoyed. It's 42. And we still have 5-10 minutes. I'm gonna give the floor to people who knew Pieter personally. I know there are several around. So if you knew Pieter personally, you might have some anecdotes on him, or if you want to take the floor.
Hi. So I knew Pieter really for 6 months when he died. I had met him 5 years ago and made this silly decision not to meet him again for 5 years. And so I had a crazy time with him 5 years ago, one evening, then decided to wait until last year hackathon that Benjamin mentioned. And I was so impressed by looking at him working inside his community that he was actually applying principle he was speaking about. Most people don't do that. They speak up, but they don't do it. And he was really, really doing it, and that really got me impressed. And so I kept in contact since January last year, which was unfortunately too late, but that's how life it is. Life is, at least I learned something. I just want to point one or two things that are related. I was really, really interested by the tweet storm when he announced his death on October 4th. I mean, for 24 hours, maybe more, all over Twitter, people were really thanking him. And I thought it was very impressive to see that what he just told about people being good for each other had some impacts in each other's life. And related to that, 2 months later, I met a girl over the internet, and we were speaking on a project, and she invites me to do pair programming over the internet, which was the first time for me. I guess most of you have done it before, but for me it was the first time. And we start to get some context, and I mentioned that I'm looking at her software because I looked at GSF from Pieter, and I saw her software because at a Pieter event I met someone that mentioned Elm to me, and Elm is a language that piqued my interest. And suddenly she is really touched because she says, oh, you know, I met Pieter, he was such a great guy, so we had no relationship at all. So I just wanted to point this open source stuff and human stuff. 2 months after he was dead, he was still there among us, so I guess that his ego must be taken care of in a way. That's it.
Yeah, I met Pieter like a few years ago. I was really troubled building distributed systems, and well, not very experienced in it. And I met his work, ZeroMQ. And you know, I can talk a lot about this technology, and Pieter was really a mentor in that field. But what struck me most was, most people probably even know Pieter, his personality, his huge personality. But it was not about technology. It was really about humans. He was really, I've never been so welcomed by somebody in a community. And this really struck me like, whoa, like there was something happening. And this was such an inspiration, and yeah, I think he kind of bundled it in this C4 collective code contract. Actually, I don't know what the C4 C's are for actually, but I think when we talk about technology, then it's always this programming, but he was really about protocols, of course, but a contract, and this is also a social contract. And I think that's a huge legacy. And yeah, when I heard that he was going to die, I was really like, we're going to lose a big thing here. How can we keep this going? And I'm really happy that I'm here again with lots of people from the ZeroMQ community, and we're doing it. He just wrote a protocol on how to do it. Have a very open and very welcoming community that's solving the problems of communities, which are always there. So, yeah, for me, Pieter was a big inspiration, and I think that's his legacy. This is something everybody can pick up, because it's a contract. It's just, you can just follow it. It's just an advice. It's not only about technology. It's even for life, and it's protocol for dying. It's translated in so many languages and broadcasted on television. I work for a television. Television in Holland now, and even on that, they knew about Pieter. They had seen his work, and I was like, okay, amazing. So, yeah, Pieter, thank you.
settled in Belgium 20 years ago, almost, and I knew Peter at that time, less than one year after I arrived. And since we were in contact, not in permanent contact, and so I see all the evolutions. And and of course, I'm not so technical anymore now, so I didn't follow the end, but of course, regarding the social the process to collaborate, it's a great inspiration. And from what Benjamin told us, and also regarding what to the Twitter storm, also what a good message I've retained is that he was always challenging. When you discuss with him, it was always challenging. He was always challenging you. So it was a great inspiration. So yes, he wrote, at the end, he wrote all these books, and you can agree, you can disagree with some of his writing, in particular when it's not technical, but it's always challenging, so it's a great legacy. We can thank you, and we will try to pursue some of his initiatives, and also toward maybe his family, which is the children, the young children. It's difficult, and you would like to make them jump into this, this story. Yes, thank you, Peter.
I met Peter about 3 years ago during my bachelor studies, and we were trying to build a peer-to-peer Dropbox. And basically, we were just trying to use it, and suddenly I was in the ZeroMQ community doing pull requests on a language I didn't even know that much at the time. Just because the process he built, working with the community, working in the community, was so much fun. And actually, working remote in the community with all of you guys is one of the greatest experiences I had in my life. It worked really, really, sometimes, most of the times, way more efficient than working with colleagues at a company. I'm not sure how that's possible, probably because of his protocols. And Peter had always great advice, and I really, really liked working with him. And I only met him last June at his wake, which was far too late because I missed a couple of opportunities, but I'm glad that I knew him.
Basically, what I consider to be these guys, to be Peter's legacy. I mean, it was not just about technology. The experience you would have with Peter would change anything that he would touch. Like, if I can speak for myself, he made me a better developer, he made me a better person, a better father, and you could talk about basically any topic with him. And he was so smart, his mind was so, like, cutting through the stuff that like, he would be a partner in any discussion with him, which was really great. And I owe a lot of things to Peter, and unfortunately I won't be able to repay any of it back. Thank you so much.
So, hello, my name is Mikhail. I met Peter at the same location as Carol because we are working in the same team. We were really lucky when we chose the ZeroMQ and decided to invite Peter for the training because, I mean, the plan was that we will learn the technology. It turns out the technology was the least important information we get. We got a lot of things from the beginning, how to write the code, how to test it, how to build it, how to iterate, how to fail fast, how to improve yourself. I still remember our discussion about the problem solution, which was, this is something trivial to think about. I mean, you have the problem and solution. This is not how most people operate. And he focused us a lot about that. It turns out that the most important information we learned was the collaboration, the community, and about the back actors, which is especially the Psychopath book is something I personally started to read recently and realized that this was the most important thing we learned about the social aspect, how to organize, how to deal with the people which are not able to work in this process. So I'm not going to repeat all those methods you already heard. So Peter, thank you. It was nice to meet you.
Hello. Yes, please allow me to speak. Even though I did not know Peter personally, I've seen him here once live on stage. It was here on FOSDEM, I think it was in 2011, and since then I was so intrigued by him, I followed his online persona. And he was called one of the real intellectuals of our community, out of which there are people like him are indeed very rare. And I just remember that in his last tweets, he wanted to be remembered mostly as an author, and his legacy is there. His books are there. They deal about software, but they deal about people. They deal about the good things in people, about fostering communities, about societies, and about the bad things too in the Psychopath Code. I find these books tremendously valuable, readable, full of creative insights and of disruptive insights and of intriguing ideas. And these books are there, one can buy them, but one can also just download them. They are as freely licensed as the software was. It's all there, and by reading his books, plenty of people can still get plenty of insights of Peter. Thank you.
My story is similar to the others, other people have told. I started working in the ZeroMQ community about 2 years ago because we needed work. And I found a small bug, so I sent a pull request like you could in this community. But in other projects that I could contribute to, normally I expect my pull request to stay there for weeks, maybe month, and be ignored. And then when someone finally looks at it, then the bike shedding starts, and no, do it red, no, do it green. But when I sent a request to CitizenQ, it was merged in about 5 minutes. And that was Peter's C4 process. It removed all the bullshit, all the bike shedding, all the arguing from the community. And it liberated us to start writing our code and make something better. because in the end, as others have said, the code might rot, it might be broken, it might be fixed, but the community is what matters. And as long as we survive as a community, the libraries and the bindings and everything else will also go on. And this is, I think, as others have said, Peter's most important legacy. So thank you, Peter.
Okay, I know nothing about codes. I'm Peter's sister, and I just want to thank you all very much for being here and for Benjamin for organizing it. I saw the kids this afternoon. They're looking healthy and they're fine. And I think my brother would have been very happy that you honored him in this way. So thanks so much. Really appreciate it. That's it. And I'm a lecturer. That's why I speak loudly.
Okay. Originally, this should have been a small reminder on the IoT Devroom very shortly, and then they asked me to make a longer talk, and I really appreciate all your contributions. And I think what is important is there's a lot of legacy around Peter, and we try to carry the spirit around for the future. Thank you. Small kids that don't have a father. And so, if there is the least thing you can do, is to buy books and donate. Thank you.
Thank you very much for visiting FOSDEM. This is the last talk here. Thank you. See you tomorrow.